Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 24 through 29. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them, and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have come to believe." Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, be with us this day. May we hear your word and may we put your word into practice now and always. Amen. There is a term out in our language called an urban legend. It's a modern day folklore. It's stories that are often thought to be factual by those circulating them. They're not necessarily untrue, but they're stories that are, There are stories that are exaggerated or distorted or sensationalized. And there is a website called Snopes.com, and it is totally dedicated to discovering whether these urban myths are true or false. So I want to share some with you that I went onto Snopes and looked up to find. I know you're all dying to know the burning question of whether these things are true or false. You can guess along with me if you want. I'll give you a second and then I'll tell you whether it's true or false. A penny dropped from the Empire State Building will embed itself into the pavement. That's true. That's false. Someone said false. That's true. It's false. Hostess Twinkies have an indefinite shelf life. That is false. You can tell if there's something big underway at the White House by the level of pizza orders that come in. That is false. A young boy's stomach exploded from eating Pop Rocks and drinking soda pop. That is false. A munchkin on the set of The Wizard of Oz committed suicide, and you can see it in the movie. That is false. Walt Disney has been cryogenically frozen. False. And Charlie Chaplin once lost a Charlie Chaplin lookalike contest. That is true. It's hard to determine the truth from the false. Some things sound true and they turn out only to be myths. And some things seem very hard to believe and then they prove to be absolutely true. And many times it's hard to know which is which and which one to go with, what line you're going to join. In today's scripture, we are looking at Thomas the disciple, a man who had a reputation of needing to be sure, a man who was known as a bit of a doubter, and Thomas liked things to be cut and dry. Thomas liked to know what was true. He liked things proven to his satisfaction. There are things that we can learn from Thomas and his encounter with Jesus, the one that took place shortly after that first Easter morning. So the disciples were in a locked room. They were scared to death that what had happened to Jesus was now going to happen to them. They were afraid they were next. Suddenly Jesus is among them. He gives them his peace. He breathes into them the Holy Spirit so that they may go out into his name. Jesus had a touching moment here with his disciples. He gave them his peace, his blessing, that their lives would be full of all good things. And he gave them a commission. He charged them, prepared them, and equipped them so that they could bring his message out into the world. All were there but Thomas. When the others told Thomas, he did not believe them. Not only that, but he required proof that Jesus had come back. He wanted to stick his hand in the wounds. He wanted to see the piercing in his side. So now that we have set the scene, let's see what Thomas teaches us today. First thing to note is that Thomas was not with the disciples the first time that Jesus appeared to them. And we don't know why. It doesn't tell us why. We just know that he was not there. Now, we could speculate why. Maybe Thomas ran away. Maybe seeing his mentor and what happened to him was too much and he needed to escape. Maybe he was trying to make sense of all that had happened and he needed time to process. Maybe being with the other disciples was too much. Maybe he needed time to be alone to figure out his next step. I list all these as possible reasons because all of us process death and grief and hard times and tragedies. We all process it in our own and different ways. And from what we know, Thomas deeply loved Jesus, and his staying away was probably his way of dealing with what was happening. Thomas being absent from the disciples also shows us how important our church family can be in times of crisis. The 11 disciples found strength in being together in fellowship with one another. They were their own community of faith. Now, I picture them together bouncing ideas off one another, talking with anxiety about what's going to happen next. I can see them reminiscing about the good times and the things that they had with Jesus, saying things like, hey, remember the time when he got mad at us because we wouldn't let the children come to him? Things like this. I can see this going on in that room. I am sure they were grieving together. I am sure they were praying with one another. And there is a line here. There are times when we, like Thomas, we need our solitude. We need our space. We need to figure things out and grieve on our own. But there are also times when we need our faith community and we need to rely on each other. Jesus knows this. And like he did with Thomas, he comes to us in these times and he gives us what we need. What Thomas needed was proof. He was a man of principle. He knew what he believed and he stood by those beliefs. For example, when Jesus got word that his friend Lazarus had died, he told the disciples that he needed to go to Judea. Now, they reminded him that the last time they were in Judea, the Jews tried to stone Jesus to death, and it may not be the best idea to go back there. It was Thomas who said, "Let us also go that we may die with him." When Jesus was explaining eternal life to his disciples, he said, "I will come back and take you to be with you so that you are also where I am. And you know the place to where I am going." And Thomas was the one who said, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" If Thomas didn't understand, he would say that. And once he understood, he stood by those principles. And making a commitment and standing by those principles is important in the way we live life. Here's my example. There was a farmer who was driving down the road and he noticed a sign at the local airport that said, "Experience the thrill of flying." The farmer thought to himself, "Tomorrow is my wife's birthday and I'd love for her to experience the thrill of flying." So the farmer went into the airport, he looked for the pilot, and after he found him, he wanted to know if him and his wife could fly with him tomorrow. The pilot owned a small one-cockpit plane, and he certainly could give the wife the thrill of a lifetime, so they started to haggle over the price. The price that the pilot was offering was too high, the farmer wanted to get the best deal possible, so they started to negotiate. And finally, the pilot agreed to the low price that the farmer was offering on the condition that the farmer and his wife had to promise while they were in the plane not to say a single word. One word spoken aloud, however small, would increase the price to the original price that the pilot was offering. The farmer's determination to give his wife the thrill of flying was only surpassed by his determination to spend as little as possible on his wife's birthday present. The next morning, the three of them took off, and soon they were soaring high in the clouds. Now, the pilot made this condition because he knew that if he could do a few roller coaster dips and turns and dive the plane, that somebody would scream and gasp out, and he would get his full prize. So with that in mind, he dipped, he turned, he climbed, he dived, he even did a couple of loop-de-loops, and not a sound was uttered. Not a scream, not a whimper, nothing but silence. And as they were landing, as they were coming down the ground, the pilot was amazed at the determination of his passengers, and he yelled back to the farmer, "I can't believe you didn't say a word. I did everything I could to make you both scream out, but you were silent the whole time. I guess you win." And the old farmer shouted back, "Well, you almost won, son. You almost won. I sure felt like screaming when my wife fell out." Just a joke. This gentleman definitely was willing to stick by his convictions no matter the price. And we see that from Thomas. He knew what he believed, and he stood by that belief. If he didn't believe in something, he was honest and brave enough to state that fact. He was a person that was true to himself. He was a man of principle. He was a man of conviction. He was a man who wanted to see and believe things on his own. And there's another characteristic of Thomas. Thomas was known as Doubting Thomas. He has that reputation. When Thomas missed that encounter with the risen Lord, he was a bit perturbed. He boldly stated, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails in his side, I will not believe." I think Thomas gets kind of a bad reputation here. He's known as Doubting Thomas, a bit of a pessimist, the one who demanded the proof. But look what happens when Jesus gave him that opportunity. In verse 27, Jesus said, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and touch my side. Do not doubt, but believe." When Jesus gave Thomas exactly what he wanted, his reaction was to say, "My Lord and my God." Nowhere in the Bible does it say that he started poking around, that he touched anything on Jesus' body. He simply, instantly made that statement and believed. Thomas doubted in order to be sure, and when he was sure, his surrender and his obedience was complete. Jesus' response was to say, "Have you believed because you have seen? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet who come to believe." I think that's us. Aren't we the ones that believe in Jesus without ever having seen him, talking to him, have a conversation with him? I think he's talking about us. I certainly think he could be talking about us, other people as well, but I think he's talking about us. I think that most of us are a lot like this disciple. I know I am. The Presbyterian Church puts a lot of emphasis on study and knowledge. To become an ordained Presbyterian minister, you have to go to school and get a 3-year master's degree. You have to pass 5 standard tests for ordination. You have to meet with a committee yearly, and they have to test you and make sure that you're ready for ministry. Then you're examined by the larger presbytery, and a church must be willing to hire you before they can ordain you. So as a minister, I have to know what I believe. I have to be able to stand by those convictions. Being trained in this manner, I have become a person who also likes to know the facts, wants to see the proof, wants to make the best informed decision possible. And this is not a bad way to live. This is an insightful, intelligent, honest, and dignified manner in which to approach the routines and the challenges of life. And when it comes to faith and relationship, I would like to think that I am like Thomas, the disciple, not in the doubting, prove it to me way, but in the my Lord, my God way. My relationship to Christ isn't really something that I can or need to prove. It isn't really something that I have to get my head around. It is something that evokes my feelings and my passion and my heart. Knowing that Christ is in the center of life and that we are all called to make a difference for God in this world, that is a privilege, that is an honor, that is an opportunity to say thank you for that great love of God. And I apologize, but this keeps coming out. I don't want things to fall off. So let's look at what Jesus is, what Jesus gives to us, how that sharpens. I'm going to move over a little bit, because either way there's a post and somebody gets left out. So I'm trying to make it so everybody can see. Let's look at what our faith is about. The bishop was coming to town, and this was no ordinary bishop. This was the most revered and beloved bishop that the church had. He was a special man. He had been left on the doorstep of a monastery when he was just a baby, just an infant. The monks had taken him in. They had loved him and trained him and got him ready for a life of service to God. And that's exactly what happened. And he became famous because of the way he could serve God. He had an insight that others didn't seem to have. He could teach Scripture in a way that was never done before, that would make people say, aha, and make them want more, and make them want to know more. He was a very kind man. He could look at you and you just knew that what he was doing was speaking the truth. He was being uncritical and unjudgmental, and people would flock to see this man because of what he knew and because of how he could teach. So when word got round the town that he was coming to this particular town, people were very excited and they were very happy, well, anxious too, because the bishop was coming to town. Well, they wanted to make a good impression, so they scrubbed the church from top to bottom. They polished and dusted everything. They shampooed the carpets. They put a coat of paint on the walls. They got the sanctuary gleaming for the bishop's arrival. They decided that he was coming for an evening worship service, so the hospitable thing to do would be to have a dinner first and invite the bishop to the dinner to make that part of his experience at the church. And so they did, and everyone brought their best dishes, not just things they could cook well. They all used those secret family recipes that you can't give out, that puts their best foot forward. They did that. They brought out the best china, and they made the hall as glamorous as they could for the bishop's arrival. And the bishop came, and they all had dinner, and they all had a good time, and then it was time to go up to the sanctuary for the worship service. And everyone was very excited. They wanted to know what this man had to say. They wanted to learn from this famous bishop. They wanted to be part of his teaching, part of that history. So they're all in the sanctuary waiting and ready for this to happen. And the bishop walks in, and he walks to the middle of the chancel, and he sees above them a great big crucifix, a great big shining, polished, gleaming crucifix. And the bishop takes out a candle and he lights it and he starts to illuminate with the candle different pieces of the crucifix that the church can see. He starts at the feet that were bound or nailed or secured to the cross, and he takes his time illuminating that part of the crucifix. And then he moves to the hands, where the nails would have been driven through and the scars would have been very pertinent and up and very out front for everyone to see. And he moves to the side where he was stabbed, right through the side with the spear, taking his time to highlight that area. Then he moves the candle to the top of Jesus' head to reveal the crown of thorns that would have pierced into the skull and made him bleed. And finally, he illuminates the face, that painful, sad face, with all the enduring, the suffering, and the sacrifice that Jesus made for the world. And when he's done illuminating everything, the bishop blows out the candle and leaves the church and goes home. Thomas was a man who needed proof, who needed to believe. We have that proof in our lives. All we have to do is look at the cross. The proof is there. Everything we could ever want, everything we need to believe is in that love, that sacrifice, the pain of the face of what Jesus does for us. We come to Jesus as people of faith. And that's what Christ means to us. We have that faith that loves him, that serves him, that wants to go out into the world and do things for Christ. And we can, because in our faith, in our proof that God is a living presence for us, we can get on our knees and we can say, "My God and my Lord." Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you. Please help us, give us the courage each and every day to do your work and to live our lives for you, now and always. Amen.